I'm smiling because I'm always happy.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
And this is the Concept Crucible Podcast.
And it's Plugcast time!
Yes! Woo! So we did this back in season one?
Yeah. I think season one was the last time we did it.
And we sort of spent a bunch of time talking about like stuff that we're watching, stuff that we're listening to, stuff that is cool and that we like.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really fun. Mm-hmm. We opted not to do one every season because we would just it would get boring.
I think there would be a lot of repetition. And even then, when I was trying to come up with some of my ideas, like my blogs and podcasts, I'm still listening to a lot of the same stuff that I did, oh God, 3-4 years ago, I guess.
And that's the funny thing for me is I wanted to do one now because I think that it's changed a bunch.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting to hear that it may not have for you.
Some stuff.
My stuff certainly has, and looking at the list that we've got, I can say that with authority.
Mm-hmm.
Partly because some of the stuff didn't exist
mm-hmm.
before when we did it, but
yeah.
A lot of it did.
Mm-hmm.
So our icebreaker is, what is the song you can't stop listening to?
Shut Up and Dance. Either Walk the Moon's original version or... Okay. Jonathan Young's cover of it. He does a cappella, and I'm going to talk about him when we talk about music.
Also, the show notes are going to be full of links to all this stuff.
Yeah, but that's the one I bought a copy of it off of iTunes from him. Actually, Jonathan Young and another guy are the first ones to push me to just go ahead and buy singles off of YouTube. Back in the day, quite a while ago, I would just go to like YouTube to MP3,
mm-hmm.
and I would rip it. And I'd be pirating their stuff off of YouTube because I didn't care about the quality of it. I just really liked it. But now, I don't know, something about turning 30, I found, is like, yep, I am willing to pay for whatever to support the people who make stuff. Maybe it's because I started making stuff.
Yeah.
I don't try to monetize it myself right now, but I can appreciate other people. And
your views give us tenths of dollars.
maybe we should start focusing on monetizing.
that's another podcast. So yours is Shut Up and Dance.
Shut Up and Dance. Nice. I don't even really I don't like dancing myself. But the song makes me want to boogie. It just makes me want to get up and move. It makes me so happy.
Nice. Mine is Nobody Speak by DJ Shadow and Run the Jewels.
Mm.
And I saw the video for it, and since then I haven't been able to get it out of my head. And Run the Jewels has been like, this is such a good year. 2016 was a really good year for them,
mm.
and we'll talk about that when we get to music.
Yeah.
But yeah, that song, like I said, link in the show notes.
Mm-hmm.
So good.
Mm-hmm.
So, what are YouTube and Twitch things? You know, video stuff that you are constantly watching, listening to?
Beyond the ones that I talked about last time, I tend to watch a lot of videos from the School of Life, so much so that I started incorporating them into my lectures. I would, especially when I was talking about love and romance and whatnot, I featured some of their videos. Same with, and I don't remember if I was watching them before the last Plugcast or afterward because of you, but I started incorporating more of the Green Brothers mm. into stuff, specifically their Crash Course series. I would use those in my lectures to help break up the monotony of it. So, School of Life is really interesting. I can never pronounce his name. Alain de Botton, I think is. Well, that's phonetically how it looks, but I'm pretty sure I'm not getting that right. Anyways, yeah, he's English European philosopher who has his whole series on YouTube. Really interesting. Are we gonna go back and forth, or do
sure.
you want me to just okay?
No,
so go ahead.
So I have been watching. No. You do all yours and I'll do mine.
Okay.
Otherwise, it'll take you long.
Okay, fair enough. So School of Life. I'm really into Boogie. 2988.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
You probably know him because
I'll click on the link in the show notes.
Yeah, Boogie, he's most known, and how I stumbled on his video is he's got a character he calls Francis. Like, Boogie, he's a big guy. Like, he's a big guy, and he talks openly about, like, his past and his eating disorders and stuff like that. But he also uses it for comedic effect when he comes out with the Francis character, the whiny, angry Game Boy kind of thing. And he's always like railing about stuff. So that I first encountered him through his Francis character, then discovered that was actually just a bit that he does, and he's got a whole bunch of other videos. Anyways, super genuine guy. I love him. He's so warm and kind on his channel. So recently I got into a channel called The Buff Dudes. Brandon and... Oh, crap. Why am I drawing a blank on the names? It's because I never prepare for stuff. But anyways, Buff Dudes is it's a workout channel. Kind of bro-y. They pull in a lot of goofy aesthetics from the 80s and whatnot. But it's not just a guy who films his workouts and blogs about it. They try to put in production value to make it kind of funny and interesting to watch. But they also do a lot of instructional videos that, you know, like their backyard workouts if you don't have gym equipment. Or if you want to do a specific routine, you know. I'm going to put this as a catch-all. I tend to watch a lot of ASMR stuff. I don't necessarily buy into the kind of hokiness of it, but I do find the videos very relaxing. The Heather Feathers, Raffy Taffy, and a few other ones. Pretty much just anything under the ASMR if you search it out.
I don't know anything. Like, I know what ASMR is, but I've never actually watched an ASMR video.
Yeah. Like, I just find it really relaxing. I do feel the tingles that they describe, but I don't really put too much stock into it. It's just interesting videos. And finally, this one is from you, because you talked about him before, and I checked him out, and I fell in love with him. His videos are amazing. I love it. Movies with Mikey.
Oh, Mikey's so good.
Mikey is so good. And I started watching his reviews or essays, and, oh, he's so good. So, yes.
Yeah. Mikey Newman does Movie Crit on old movies, on bad movies, and he's the guy who will watch a movie 8 times and tell you the little tiny pieces of it that make it amazing, even when you hated it.
Yeah. Now, what was, more background for him, what was his involvement with Borderlands? Like, was he creator or just the writer?
He was a writer.
Okay.
He's a writer on Borderlands 1 and 2, I believe.
Yeah.
And he's been involved in a ton of other projects surrounding that. Like movies with Mikey, for instance, he runs on Chainsaw Suit with Chris Straub, who is also a genius. Mm-hmm. So my first one, I guess, which isn't on my list, but it is a thing I found through movies with Mikey, is Monster Factory, which is run by the McElroy brothers, who are a big deal, apparently, if you're anybody but me, because I'd never heard of them until, like, last year.
Hmm. I remember when he gave a shout-out to them.
Yeah, Monster Factory is... Oh, my God. I thought, I'm going to hate this. And I watched it, and I couldn't stop laughing. It's so funny. And they do. They love those people. Knife Dad is best dad. I've been watching a ton on Twitch and on YouTube of Adam Coble's stuff. Skinny Ghost on Twitter. He, in addition to playing video games and playing RPGs... Adam Coble was the co-designer for Dungeon World, which is an RPG, a tabletop RPG that I deeply enjoy. And he spends a lot of time thinking about games, which conveniently so do I. I caught him because he was doing GM prep for a show that he runs on Roleplay. And I was like, this is delightfully dorky. It was right after we got back from Scotland.
Mm.
And I must have watched 200 hours in the remainder of my vacation. And I'm just hooked. Right now they're running Court of Swords, which is a sort of tarot-inspired D&D game on Roleplay. And in addition to that, on his own channel, he's doing prep. He's doing all kinds of other work. He's playing Earthbound and Dishonored 2 and other games that, you know, that either I haven't played in a long time or I want to play. And he's a really cool dude to watch and hang out with. I've been watching a lot of card games in my other monitors. Magic the Gathering stuff from Channel Fireball. Guys like Frank Lepore and LSV. I'll be honest, nothing gives me more joy than watching Louis Scott Vargas draft a cube of some kind and just ruin someone's day. Like, I'm not good at Magic. I'm a fake Magic fan. I play Magic like twice a year, but I watch these people play Magic at a level that is completely beyond mine, and I admire seeing it done well. I also watched Trump play Hearthstone.
It's an unfortunate name now.
It's an unfortunate name now, but he's been making Hearthstone content longer than there's been presidential election.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, such is life.
But I imagine there's a fair number of listeners and viewers right now that's like, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, no. He's a streamer. Does mostly strategy games, and almost all Hearthstone now. Mm-hmm. Because he's also a pro Hearthstone player. Non-video game stuff. To go along with the movies with Mikey, Every Frame a Painting. If you want to learn about cinematography and sound design, putting films together, the ways that, like, whether it's because you want to make films, which I don't, or you just want to like appreciate them in more deeply.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing. It's
sorry, finish your sentence.
I was just gonna remark that yeah, like it's got me whenever I watch movies sort of listening and looking in ways that I wasn't before.
Mm-hmm.
And seeing things that I hadn't examined.
The first time I encountered one of his videos was when he did the Marvel Cinematic Universe music one.
Mm-hmm.
Where he goes out and he asks people to like hum the Avengers theme or something, and he made this whole entire essay concerning just how poorly Marvel is handling their cinematic universe's score and musical contributions.
Mm-hmm.
It was so interesting. And that from that video, boom, instant subscribe for me.
You'll get that. You'll get, if you watch that video, you'll see that this scene from Captain America Winter Soldier, where he pulls all the sound out of it except for the music.
Mm-hmm.
It's gold. It's gold.
Yeah.
I've also been watching Rap Critic.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, just backed his Patreon. He used to be way back. He used to be on the same site as Linkara.
Mm-hmm.
And
I think he still is.
I think so too. But I picked him up on YouTube.
Yeah.
And from some other stuff.
I think from a background point of view, they used to all be on Blip, and then Blip ceased, so they just all migrated to YouTube as a stable source.
So I've been constantly, I love hip-hop music, but I am a guest in the house of hip-hop.
Mm-hmm.
And he gives me a really interesting perspective into the history of it and the perspectives on it, rather than me just listening to a song and going, I like that song, and I like it for reasons, but I don't have all the context that I'd want to have.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm learning a ton. The one I didn't mention, another one I didn't put on the list because it was so commonplace, is I'm still watching the shit out of Loading Ready Run. They've been streaming for 4 years. They're doing a ton of new stream content. They're playing board games. They're running D&D. They do a variety show every 2 weeks that is live.
Mm-hmm.
God, it's amazing as hell.
I gotta do one more plug from your list, from the Rap Critic. My favorite episode of his was his analysis of Coolio's Gangster's Paradise.
Mm,
I love that. I've watched it multiple times and I keep coming back to it because it is such a good analysis.
Mm-hmm.
If you're gonna watch any of them, I would suggest starting with that one. But
links in the show notes.
Yeah, sorry, I had to jump in because I just love that episode.
So blogs that you're reading, go.
Okay, I've started reading a lot of financial blogs, which, as you comment in the pre-show, no surprise there.
Yeah, seriously. Huck reads blogs. Like once again, the thing we learned about Huck in the last podcast is that he interacts with the internet like a 40-year-old man, and I interact with the internet like a 15-year-old girl.
Yeah.
This is still true.
Yep. So I read a lot of The Financial Diet, which is, it was founded by, I don't know where they started. I think now they're both in New York. Chelsea Fagan and Lauren, I'm not sure what her last name is because I think she just got married. So I'm not sure if she professionally changed her surname or not. But anyways, Chelsea and Lauren started The Financial Diet with, actually it was supported initially through some sort of grant or business venture through John.
Aboard Already, what's it about?
John Green. Anyways, oh no, John Green. Hank Green helped him to get it off the ground.
Sure.
Anyways, their demographic is more geared towards millennial, early career professional women. And I've actually written two articles for them as a guest contributor, but I find... you're big important, but but I find the information, even though it is kind of ostensibly written for that crowd, is applicable for almost anybody who's first starting out, and really accessible. And it's there's a lot of guest posts by the average person, so it gives you a wide variety of different experiences. I also read Seth Godin, who I think you gave the best example of, or the best description of what his blog is. What is it?
If you throw enough shit at a wall, some of it will stick.
And that is exactly what it is. He's got a daily post. Usually it's no more than a couple lines. Some of it's really good. Some of it, meh, you can take it or leave it.
Charitable.
Yeah, when he talks about the breakpoints one, interesting. You know, you had one that was interesting.
Four Horsemen of Mediocrity.
Yeah, so yeah, take it or leave it. But I read it every day. I check in every day. Another financial one, Make Smarter Decisions. I don't know much about the author. She's retire-ish. Like, she sometimes comes back and does part-time teaching or vice principal contracts, but she doesn't need to work. But she did a master's in decision theory.
Nice.
And so she does some consulting on the side. So she posts the ways that she goes about making decisions. So, for example... doing a rental property thing. She showed her decision-making matrix in terms of how she went about doing an analysis.
If I needed a Nash equilibrium.
Yeah, I think she'd probably talk about that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I really enjoy
it. Sometimes you just need a good Nash equilibrium.
Yeah.
Gotta get those Nash Browns.
And another blog that I've run into recently, Mark Maron, who he released a book last year called The Subtle Art of Not Giving a Fuck. I enjoyed the book. I listened to it on audiobook. It was my first purchase on Audible.
Something in my brain says Mark Maron's podcast was the first podcast that the president was ever on.
Maybe.
But.
He might have a podcast. I don't follow everything he does, but I started following his blog, and I enjoy more of the content than I tend to dismiss. So.
Blogs for me. I have not been reading as many blogs. Like, I had a whole bunch of blogs that I followed, like, every update, every post. And now, especially with the rate at which news is coming in, I find that I spend a lot more time on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
And what I will do is I will find out what is happening from Twitter, and then I will look for journalism about it. And I drift farther and farther away from think pieces about news, like specifically about news, and toward like journalism. I read think pieces about other stuff, like pop culture and marginalized perspectives and things like that. But if I want to know what's happening in government, I will go I will specifically go and look up journalism.
Although apparently now that's going to be limited because, as of filming, a bunch of outlets were barred from the White House.
They intend to keep reporting, and I salute them for it. Yeah. But I do. There are a bunch of blogs that and writers that I continue to follow around. Obviously, my first shout out goes to Matt Art Lab, where I am a contributor, in general, the Skeptic Network. But we talk about art and science and all kinds of weird stuff. I talk about books a lot, and I spend time reading old science fiction and fantasy books and talking about, not even reviewing them, just important themes and things that are interesting. And I talk about social justice and steampunk things sometimes. Chuck Wendig, who runs Terrible Minds, is the best guy I've ever seen for no nonsense professional writer stuff. Like, if you want to be a professional writer, discipline over inspiration, Chuck's your guy.
It's funny, you mentioned his name, and then just in this last week, I've noticed that I've been cued to references to him. He's written, what, three in canon, like within canon of the Disney era Star Wars books.
Yeah, he's writing for the new Star Wars Expanded Universe.
Yeah, it was so weird. Like, oh, there's all this information coming out that helps connect episode 6 to episode 7. And I'm looking at the author. I know that name. That's from our plug cast.
Or it will be. It will be. It will have been.
That's funny.
Rebecca Stavers is one angry woman. She writes about feminism and intersectionality. Also, Ijoma Oluo, who writes about the same kind of stuff at Medium and The Establishment. And she also has a Patreon. She makes really... And I've referenced her articles before on the podcast, and it's sort of powerful stuff from different perspectives, and that's one of those things that I've been trying to broaden. I've also been reading everything over at Black Girl Dangerous. Same reasons. There are strong articles, and there are strong articles about shit that I probably haven't thought about enough, which is worth doing.
Mm-hmm.
And because I'm a monster, I'm just going to roll into podcasts. But links are always in the show notes.
Mm-hmm.
I have been listening to a ton of podcasts, which is weird because I didn't used to. Often I watch more streams than I do listen to podcasts, but early morning podcasts are becoming a thing, like podcasts while I play video games.
Mm-hmm.
Sidewalk Slam gives me everything I want out of wrestling without having to fucking watch wrestling. Sidewalk Slam's run by the Loading Ready Run crew. It's Graham Stark and Adam Savadan, and they talk about the story of wrestling and like contemporary storylines that are happening. Again, much like the Rap Critic, they are huge super fans of this, so that I don't have to be. They have all this historical context going back 20 years that I never learned, and I learned from them, sort of on their knee. And I love hearing about it, like partly because they're really funny guys, and they're really cool, but also, you know, and enthusiasm is infectious. But also, like, wrestling tells me a lot of stuff about D&D and how to be a better GM and things like that, because D&D and wrestling have more in common than they are different. They are both dramas, they are both sort of pantomimes or opera style things, and they center around fighting.
Mm-hmm.
And often they center around, like, not just the act of fighting, but the drama of fighting.
Mm-hmm.
And the drama of combat and contest. And, I mean, that's almost every D&D game's about that. Mine certainly is, too. Friendshipping, I just started listening to. It's run by, I can't remember their names, but they're from, they work for Cards Against Humanity. And it's all about how to be good at being friends. You know, and that means, their statement is always, you friendship at the problem. And it's really interesting. They have a different way of thinking about friendship than I do, in that they, like everybody else that I listen to, they think about it more than I do. And every once in a while, I'll hit an episode where I'm like, yep, that's me, I do that. Or I have done that. Or, you know, I'll think about opportunities that I had, or like things that I just didn't think you could, you know, talk to people about or do with people, or conversations that are really tricky to have. And they do a really good job of talking about that. So I really like it. Maker's Hustle, which is run by Amy Davis Roth, and a roboticist from New York and a pro maker. In addition to her, so they have an artist, a roboticist, and a general maker. And they talk about being makers and making it pay. Like being, doing it for a living, and what you got to do to get that moving. And they've been running that podcast for about a year now, and it's fantastic. I mean, I'm not a professional maker, but I learn a bunch about the notion of doing art job from doing it. Partly just the fact that I don't want to do art job.
Mm-hmm.
Like, but I mean, that is a good thing to learn.
Maybe just for context, art job.
Art job. So like doing art for a living, making videos, making podcasts, making music, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, it is a hard life. It is also a different life,
mm-hmm.
and it is not one that I am in a position for yet. And I listen to a bunch of pop culture podcasts. Mm-hmm. Jay and Miles Explain the X-Men.
Really good.
Witch Please, which is all about Harry Potter. Yeoman on the Bridge, which is all about Star Trek Next Generation. And just this morning, I started, literally this morning, I started the first episode up at about 6 a.m. I started listening to Tannis, which is a sort of history, fiction, conspiracy podcast. Like, it's a radio play. And I had never listened to a radio play podcast before. That's not true. I've listened to one. But, and it's so good. I'm hooked.
Hmm.
I'm disappointed because there's only like 15 episodes left. But they're just starting their new season.
Hmm.
So yeah, those are all my podcasts. I mean, that I have room in my life for. Also this one.
Oh yeah. Yeah, can't forget about this humble attempt at shouting into the void. My podcasts. So I mean, I still listen to a lot of the ones that I talked about before. I think last time I talked about Dan Carlin's Hardcore History, but I did not talk mm-hmm. about the other show that he runs, which is, why did I just draw a blank on it? Common Sense.
No pressure.
Yeah. For some reason, because I looked at The Current, which is, I'll talk about in a second, but Dan Carlin also runs another one, which is more commentary on political stuff, he calls it Common Sense, and I guess I listened to that more frequently than the other show, only because Hardcore History, the episodes are 3-4 hours long and they take months to produce, so he's able to pump out Common Sense at a slightly more regular pace. But otherwise, I just recently got into Tim Ferriss, and so the Tim Ferriss Show, and the podcast, great. I ended up purchasing his latest book, Tools of Titans, and I'm enjoying reading that.
Mm-hmm.
Super interesting, and I like his interview style. And I think, actually, listening to his interview style and then the questions that he asks of people who are professional interviewers makes me want to start taking notes for next year's Maker Expo.
Ooh.
Because I realized, while interviewing people, I suck at interviewing people.
It's not that bad.
Yeah, but I want
to... Link to our Maker Expo podcast.
I want to do better. I want to do better. And so, so Tim Ferriss, since I just mentioned it, The Current, which is a program, a week daily current events program on the CBC by Anna Maria Tremonti. Super interesting. She's a great interviewer. They always highlight three really interesting conversations to be had.
Mm-hmm.
And also things that you weren't even aware of. Recently on Friday, they featured two refugees who crossed over in Manitoba and just let them tell their stories of why they left their home countries and how they both kind of shipped over to South America, went into the States. They met up with each other, found they were both from the same country, and then decided to make their way north to Canada. So it's just like how brutal of a winter crossing it was for them.
Mm-hmm.
And then the last one is Reasonably Sound, which was a, I guess you call it a side project of Mike Rugnetta, who runs the PBS Ideas show on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
So he started a podcast. He's a little bit of an audiophile. He really likes sound and the history of recording. So so he has a show entirely dedicated to sound. So really, really interesting, and I really enjoy his stuff.
Mm-hmm. Music?
Music. At the top of the show, mentioned Jonathan Young. He does weekly cover songs, often of Disney, but he does also some anime covers and whatnot. Super love his stuff. His stuff was what inspired the Song of Month Challenge for me.
Oh, neat.
He was the guy, not that I'm like, I could do that, but it was more along of, like, this is super cool. He's really talented because he's practiced, but it would be really cool to do something similar to that. And it was the Shut Up and Dance, I think, that was the song that kind of precipitated it. But speaking of weekly covers, Leo from Frog Leap Studios.
Mm-hmm.
Really enjoy his stuff. I mean, I'm a metalhead. I think the first song I heard from him was his cover of Let It Go from Frozen. You know, just the metal cover of it. So super, super cool guy, and consistently good production. I think he basically records all the music himself. He records all the music videos himself. And as far as I know, he does the editing. So, I recently stumbled across, and I forgot that it was a thing because it took forever to produce. But Serpentine Dominion released their album recently, which is a supergroup fusion of Adam Duckowitz from Killswitch Engage and George Corpse Grinder Fisher from Cannibal Corpse. And a few other people contributed. For example, the vocalist Jesse Leach from Killswitch wrote a lot of the lyrics for the album. But basically, it's just Adam and George kept finding themselves on the same giant tours, like not the tours, but like the concert circuits and summer shows. And they're like, hey, the guitarist to the vocalist is like, I want to write music for you. We need to do this. And when you guys aren't recording music and when we're not recording music, we should record music together. So it took like 6 years to bring this idea to fruition. And they just dropped their album recently. And I'm loving it because I love Adam's guitar work. And I love Corpse Grinder's vocals. It's just amazing. It's a wonderful match. And then, more commercially, I'm almost embarrassed to say this because it's not like I'm plugging something.
Shame. Yeah,
I'm not plugging something new, per se, but I'm really enjoying Metallica's new album, Hardwired. Just,
yeah. They're touring in our area soon.
Yeah, we tried to get tickets. We couldn't get it for the Toronto show. They were so sold expensive. Out. Well, we were going to pay for it regardless. I saw them last in 2003, so it's the same reason why I justified seeing Sabbath the last three times they came through this area. Mm-hmm. Because, like, you never know when you might see them again. So,
yeah. So for me, I am not a metalhead. I have been listening to, obviously, a ton of Carsey Blanton. I mean, we went and saw Carsey Blanton in October, and it was amazing, and she was a super good time, and we got to have dinner and hang out. Run the Jewels dropped their new album before Christmas, and during Christmas, essentially, because I was working during Christmas, and I was listening to it basically nonstop, and it's really good. I Fight Dragons was a band I discovered this year that's more of like a pop rock thing, but bits of I Fight Dragons like stuck with me around the election, and I think Kaylee's responsible for that. Other rappers I've been following are Samus. She does nerdcore hip-hop and sort of like aggressively feminist nerdcore, and she is awesome. I've been listening to a ton of K-pop in general, like just Spotify K-pop lists. I've found the virtue of listening to really active songs that don't have lyrics in a language that I understand. And as always, I have the world's largest art crush on Janice Lee, who I believe also put out an album early last year. Is currently working on sort of a musical documentary. Janice Lee is my town's former artist in residence and is a generally awesome person. I mean, so that covers a lot of our, you know, watching, reading, listening stuff. Although, one of the things we didn't talk about, and I haven't prep talked for this because I literally thought of it halfway through this podcast, is
the art of being concise.
Yeah, well, it's social media stuff.
Oh, yeah.
So if you could recommend one person to follow on Twitter, who would it be? I will do the favor of going first. Because yeah. I had time to think about it.
I don't use Twitter, so. I mean, I use it.
Well, I mean, or social media in general, but Twitter is I don't know, I'm on Twitter all the time, so. For me, I gained great joy out of following Zoe Quinn. It was at Unburnt Witch. Right now, she's working on the Chuck Tingle FMV game. And on top of working on Crash Override stuff. You know, Crash Override is a sort of a harassment, an internet harassment defense network. Maybe the best way to describe it. We'll put a link in the show notes. We've linked it before, too. And she's otherwise a pretty delightful human being. And I enjoy... I find strength in watching other people overcome adversity. Even if that adversity is like, I don't feel like getting out of fucking bed. Because sometimes I don't feel like getting out of fucking bed. And I'm like, no. They can do it, so can I. You know, take one foot, put it in front of the other, see where that gets you. now the pressure's on.
It is so on.
Oh.
It is so on. I'm trying to cycle through Instagram because that's the one that I use.
Instagram be your jam. I don't really use Instagram.
I'm trying to cycle through.
Follow one person on your Instagram. Who would it be?
You know what? Like, and this
is it just you? Because no, it's just you.
No, I'm gonna say the person that that I see the most updates, and this is probably a feature of the algorithm. But also, she is super. So I just she's just super awesome, and I would say Christy Goss.
Yeah,
here in town,
Christy's amazing.
She's the only person that I can think of who is almost always at the top of my feed. She's run every day for the last like 400 days.
That's because she's ridiculously hardcore and awesome.
But the commitment, like I admire the commitment. Even if it's a 2K, you know, she does 10Ks occasionally, but 2Ks. She's recently I think bummed out her knee or something like that. But she still pushes through the yoga.
She was responsible for organizing the sudden death yoga off at the last Headshots from the Heart.
Awesome. Yeah. So that's the only person that's like, I'm trying to think of like
no, that's
artists or whatever. Like, I'm like, no,
you have chosen lightly.
It's Christy in my mind is the person that I wanna plug.
Go and follow Christy Goss on Instagram because she's really cool.
Yeah.
And that is what we will leave you with. Please, if you think that there are things that we should watch or listen to or hang out with, by all means, leave them in the links. Or in the comments. We'll put all the links in the show notes. And, I don't know. Keep listening to weird shit.
Yeah.
Thinking about reading things by people who think about it more than you do. Et cetera, et cetera. I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
We're signing off.
Stay awesome.
Legit, Christy? Nicely done. No, that's totally legit.
It's just like I was so excited by that. I was trying to go through and like I was thinking of like artists. Oh, I'm like, man, no, there's no real artists or musicians.
I was gonna guess like when you were like, oh, you know, it's probably algorithms, and I'm like, it's Jason David Frank. It's fucking Jason David Frank.
It did not even come across my thinking process.
No, that's amazing. I was trying to, you picked exactly the right answer.
Yeah. No, it was literally like I'm willing to bet. That if I were to open up the app and upload or update, I'm pretty sure she would be in the top like 10.
Now we have to see.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's from earlier. That was from earlier. Oh, there you go. There you go, Christy Goss. First one.
Show the camera.
So it's a yoga one posted 3 hours ago.
Bam.
Yeah.
You're not wrong, my friend.
It's not really, but yeah, I told you. It's probably a feature of the algorithm, but I'm not disappointed by that.